Welcome to my channel, I'm Dr. Romano. Today's video, we're gonna discuss an interesting accomplishment so far. And on LinkedIn, I have 1,500 subscribers, or if you wanna call those followers. Also, there's a number of other people that actually connected to my profile on LinkedIn. So, and I wanna thank all of you on LinkedIn for following me and subscribing on YouTube as well. And I would like to also thank the YouTube subscribers for subscribing. Thank you again. And I created this channel because I wanted to get out in the industry and I wanted to educate the public on hedge funds. Since I'm Dr. Hedge Fund on YouTube, there's a reason why I named myself that. Yes, I'm a doctor of hedge fund selection. And so there's a number of calls and emails that I get, and a lot of people ask me a lot of questions. And so I want to say thank you so much for sending me those emails and asking all those questions. And of course, I would like to answer some of those questions in this video. So the first question is, how do I select a hedge fund? That's a very good question. And when you ask a hedge fund manager, what is your strategy? That person is not gonna tell you their actual strategy, because if they do, then you could just copy it, right? So there's no edge in the market that that person would have if he told everyone, correct? So in a roundabout answer, reply to that question, I do not use the traditional measures on selecting funds, because in today's environment and today's risks associated with investments, using risk measures that are over 30, 40 years old, it doesn't make sense. There should be something better and improve that. But by the year 2008, the industry approved that those risk measures were out of date in today's markets. Because if those risk measures were useful, then they would have predicted what happened in 08 and 09. And so that's something that it's one of the reasons why I started my PhD at that time. And I knew I always wanted to become a doctor of finance since I'm like 20. And it was just a matter of getting there, and the right time happened, and that's how it works out. But part of, you know, giving up your secrets is not possible. So you could read my dissertation, and at that time, that was interesting data that was concluded by a lot of the data that I was reading and researching. And I proved that data with actual hedge fund returns, whether or not the size of a fund affects their returns, whether or not the age affects their returns. So in other words, everything that I researched is the returns of a hedge fund. That's what we're talking about today. And if you don't know what a hedge fund is a one or two person team, or it could be a large team, but we're talking about the little people, the little companies out there. They're one or two people trading on a particular market. What is the best market? Well, that's the equities market, because the equities market has an enormous amount of liquidity. And that's what a trader needs. A trader's not buying an actual gold coin and storing it in a safe. That's a real asset. A piece of real estate is a real tangible asset. And so, unfortunately, with real estate, and that's, you know, if there's no market for that, then you lose your money, or the value goes down. But with a equity stock, let's say, the prices go up and down every day, every second, every year, every 10 years. It's just, that's how it is. But a trader could actually make money on both sides, whether it goes up or down. And there's many ways that they do that. So that's what a hedge fund is, an investment company that trades on a particular market. And as for a funds of funds, that's a portfolio of hedge funds. And so that's what I specialize in. And that's what I wanted to become professional, diligent at, understanding every aspect of selecting and deselecting a hedge fund and how to create a portfolio of that so that the client's capital doesn't get diminished or lost, however you want to say it. Now, what the problem with the industry is that they're using the same risk measures that they are used to using at the investment bank. And so they're coming into the hedge fund world because they lost their job at the investment bank. And typically people who are in their 40s find it harder to work for the investment bank. And so they venture off in other industries, or they have their experience, whether it's 5 or 10 years, and they move over to the hedge fund industry field, or whatever you want to call it, sector. Now, the reason why I specialized in hedge fund selection is because I started out on the trading floor and I loved the energy there, but when I was going to college, I noticed in the book of occupational titles, when I searched for that particular job, the average job length was 2.5 years to 5 years. And so I automatically knew that it wasn't going to be a 20-year career. Because when you think of a career, you want to stay in the same place, right? But that changed after the 1980s. Something happened with our federal government where they changed the fact that the companies held the pensions. Now the people hold their own pension. And that's very important, because if the company goes bankrupt, you have nothing. There's no pension. And so the government protected the public. But by doing that, people realized that they didn't have to stay at the same company for their whole career. And companies also realized that they didn't have to keep people for 20, 30 years because they could just fire them. They didn't have to pay them out. They were already paid out each year. And so that's a major difference what happened. But what it created after the 1980s, before that, you started at that company XYZ and you retired from XYZ. So let's think about how that plays a role in your coworkers, your connection with them. It's almost like they're brothers and sisters. You go to their weddings, you hang out with their family, you know everything about them. And so the quality between the connection between your coworker is much stronger. And now one of the reasons why I'm mentioning this is because when you start off at an investment company, investment bank, to get in, because there's only a handful left because of the mergers of the 1980s and 90s, it became really hard to get a job. And so typically the only way that you can get a job is either go to an Ivy League school and you get recruited based on your grades and the fact that where your application is on the pile. Your relative works at the investment bank and gets you a job, or someone that your family knows, or your dad could be the head trader, or your husband could be the head trader or a director, or your uncle is the head trader. Whoever it is, that's a connection. And so today, how I got my first job at the investment bank was through a connection. And it was a best friend that gave me that. And it was his best friend that gave him his job. So that's how that works out. And I knew, since I'm very young, I didn't want to work for a company. I knew I had to start somewhere and I had to get the feeling. But in the end, I always wanted to have my own company. And so I thought about it and I'm like, well, I can't own a bank, right? My daddy and mommy is not billionaire. And at that time, banks were actually, small banks were losing a lot of money because they weren't big enough. They couldn't compete with the big people, the big banks. So I thought about it and I said, I want to learn about hedge funds. And that's what I did. I went to school and I studied and studied and studied and studied. And so that will answer your question on that first question. How do you select a hedge fund? There's a lot that goes into it. I can't give you all that out because there's a lot of funds of funds that are calling me up now. And I appreciate that you call me, but you're asking very detailed questions. And unfortunately, you shouldn't be asking me that. That's private information. Now, you could read my book, my first book, but that's old information. And my second book is the new updated version, 8 years later, 7 years later. And so over this past 7 years, I've improved the investment selection process. I've taken out a lot of stuff and I added new stuff in. And basically the goal is to predict how well a hedge fund trader will do in a particular market. And so that's basically the goal, what you want to do for a funds of funds. And so the next question is, do I want to have my own funds of funds? Well, that's the reason why I went to school, was to have my own funds of funds. And why would someone invest in a funds of funds as opposed to a mutual fund or any other type of investment? Not everyone could invest in a funds of funds or a hedge fund. You have to be an accredited investor, and depending on what the laws are now, they changed. I don't know, we're in America, so it could be different in another country, but typically you have to be an accredited investor. That means someone who has a net wealth value. It could be $1 million, it could be whatever. And so if you noticed, a lot of hedge funds, the newer ones today, are requiring a minimum of $1 million or more to invest. Before that, it was a lot less. It was like $100,000, $250,000, etc. But you have to remember, the hedge fund has expenses. They have to pay an administrator, they have to pay a hedge fund accountant, and an audit company, as well as office space and everything else. They need a place to store the records. So they, depending on the laws of your local country, it has to be where you work or whatever the laws are. And so that's all expenses. And so that's why hedge funds charge 1 to 2% of the total capital and 20% of the returns. The returns of what they actually generate at the end of the year. What's interesting is, so a hedge fund is not risky or less risky than a mutual fund. You can't look at it like that, okay? To be quite honest with you, I'm a doctor of finance, and I will tell you that an investment bank is more riskier to invest in than a hedge fund. Okay, and there's many reasons for that. So when people measure risk, they're using these typical risk measures that I've proved in my hedge fund research, and that's with real hedge fund data, real returns, that it doesn't work. You can't use those old risk measures in today's market style because it's international market. There's nanoseconds that are traded, and everything else. So the reason why those risk measures were created in the first place is because the traders at the investment bank, they were very junior and they really didn't know what they were doing. So they created risk management to help them improve and reduce risk for the company. Hedge funds are in a whole different class. They're not a junior trader at an investment bank or on a trading floor. There's a reason why they started their own company. That's number one. Number one, they took the responsibility into their own hands. And that's very important for being an entrepreneur or someone that is very successful. Because when you work for a company, you're going to get a fixed income for the rest of your life if you're lucky to stay there, or if you're lucky to get job after job after job. And pretty much after a certain point, you're going to give up. So the point is that if that you want the actual responsibility, you will start your own company. That's just in you. But many people can't do that. They want that salary, that paycheck every month. And that's okay, because that's what they're good at. Some people are really good at managing other people in a group. That's their expertise. Now, for me, I fall asleep. That's not my expertise. My expertise is an analyst. And I always knew that since I was a little kid. I'll tell you something funny. I'm not trying to brag, but I had to get my IQ tested because I entered a special program before I started college. And it was because my parents, they wanted me to do really well. So they basically, the program was having a tutor for every single course that you take. That's a lot of money. And it was around $10,000 per year back then. And all of my tutors were professors that taught that class, but at a different section. And in order to get into that, I had to get an IQ test, etc. And it turned out that my visual and my, it was very high. It was higher than Albert Einstein. So that's why I'm the analyst. I could predict things. I see patterns. And part of being really successful on being someone in finance, you have to see patterns. So if you don't see those patterns, I mean pattern recognition, then it's kind of hard. And in my case, I have looked at so many hedge fund returns. When I started out at the investment bank, I was looking at the trading desk returns. So my job was to review the trading books to make sure it was accurate, to make sure it was reported. And if there was areas that were in red, meaning overexposed, what was going on with risk management? Were they, you know, handling it, etc.? Because sometimes it was just an error that the computer, I don't know, whatever happened. But sometimes it was real, or sometimes back then, because it wasn't fully automated, because the investment banks had bought out so many companies and merged together that every company had a different risk reporting system. And it was the time when computers were evolving so fast that companies didn't want to create a new risk reporting system because it was outdated by the time they finished putting it in. So then when I started, the vice president who I work for, my best friend, he was hired to revamp the trading books. And so I got to see that firsthand, how they measure risk, why they use a particular risk measure, the tweaking of that risk measure, because at the beginning they were tweaking it too tight that everything was becoming exposed when it really shouldn't have. So they had to keep measuring it. And so it was great to be a part of that group and at that time. But I knew I wasn't gonna stay there, because my best friend, who was the person that hired me, he says, "Anthony, traders don't last. And the stress that's involved is beyond normal. Do you really want to do that?" And of course, everyone wants to make millions of dollars, right? But the fact is that when I started to look around and I started to know people, they didn't last very long. Only one or two people lasted a long time. And that typically becomes the trader, the head trader. And so I just couldn't understand why the company was recruiting juniors from Ivy League schools or people who they know, and then giving them an opportunity to trade. And then you have a 5-year period where they have to learn, and then give them the chance. And then if they don't do good after the year, a couple of years, they're gone. I just didn't like that. And I realized that in order to really last in that industry, because I love the stock market, I love finance, is to have your own company. And finally, after I started to realize what that was it was a hedge fund, because that's an investment company, not an investment bank. So we call hedge funds, but they're really investment companies. That's what they are. And so I focused on everything that I had to learn, improve, et cetera, over that time period. And so that's why I want my own funds of funds. And I get a lot of emails asking me, you know, about my hypothetical funds of funds and what it is exactly. And so basically, to make this really quick, I believe with the data that's in front of me, the equities market is the best market. I'm not looking to diversify in every type of market. Unfortunately, when you diversify too much, your returns get watered down. So a 7% return or a 20% return yearly is really disgusting. That's really low. And so that's where things change. And so my focus is on producing quality returns for the funds of funds. And part of that is selecting in a group the exact keys that combine the returns together in all the different type of markets. So think of a bunch of keys that fit. Each key has to fit into a certain section. So I basically created a blueprint of what that looks like. In other words, because I looked at so many hedge fund returns and funds of funds returns through different databases, in other words, if you listen to this, you don't know where to find a hedge fund, you need to subscribe to a hedge fund database, funds of funds database, whatever you want to call it. And from there, there's about maybe 10,000 hedge funds. Not every database is going to have them all listed. Some have a couple of thousand, some have 17,000, some are global. It's just, it's really hard to find, you know, hedge funds. So you have to do a lot of work, because you can't just look at the first one you come across and say, oh, I like this personality of the person that pitched me for capital. It doesn't work like that. The person could be have no personality, but their returns are quality. And so that changed. So the investment banks trying to look for funds, they come into the picture and they're looking at the person's resume. The resume means absolutely nothing. Looking at the person where they went to school means nothing. Again, we think that people that go to Ivy League schools, they're qualified. That has nothing to do with trading. I would say that's good with management, because you'll be articulated and spell perfectly and write perfect emails. And remember, have a good short-term memory. In other words, go into a meeting and regurgitate it to the next meeting. So that's a good manager. But for someone that's going to improve something, that's a trader. That's an entrepreneur. Entrepreneurs look at whatever it is, and they come up with the ideas in their head to improve it continually. And that's what a trader does. They improve their risk. Their risk management technique. Trading is all about managing your losing trades. I don't know if you know about that, what trading is, but your winning trades are gonna win, but it's those losing trades that give you heartburn and make you wanna drink a bottle of whiskey. I'm being funny. We're on YouTube. I don't have HR coming after me. That's another thing that has to go. The way HR recruits people is very elementary, honestly. But I don't have to worry about that, thank God. So that's why I want to have my own funds of funds, and I like the equities market, and particular strategies, typically long or short, or short or long, whatever you want to call it. Those are their best hedge funds to look for. But since I looked at so many hedge funds, there were several of them, not several, I would say a couple of them out of 5,000 or 2,000 that I did like a multi-strategy. So I selected a couple of hedge funds that have multi-strategy, which I liked, because I measured them in different type of markets and they seem to do really well. So I can't call the fund, the hypothetical fund, a long or short funds of funds. It's really a multi-strategy funds of funds. The next question is, have I started that funds of funds? I haven't started yet. It's all in the planning. I have the administrator selected. Part of selecting an administrator, there are certain reasons why I've selected the administrator that I did, and that is MG Stouffer. MG Stouffer is a great company. They're not the largest, they're not the smallest, and so I didn't want to just go with a big bank. I would have loved that, but unfortunately, once you start, you kind of get lost in those big companies. Now, for funds of funds, you need an administrator, as well as a hedge fund accountant. And so I've selected Richie May for that because Richie May, one, the owner's still at the company, and that's extremely important because they're responsible for the auditing of each of the funds, meaning each hedge fund has an independent audit company to come in, but my hedge fund accountant is responsible for making sure that those papers are in order, everything's been reviewed, and then they send that to the administrator. And administrator keeps that on file, make sure that, you know, if we get audited by whoever, everything's in place. That's why today investing in a funds of funds is a lot safer than maybe 20 years ago. But you have to remember 20 years ago, nobody wanted to hear about a funds of funds. It's only now, this past few years, that people are taking a funds of funds very seriously. Because remember, you need a lot of capital to invest in several hedge funds. And you can't just put your capital into one or two. It doesn't work like that. Because every hedge fund does a different type of outcome in a certain type of market. So just going blindly and investing your capital in a couple of different hedge funds, thinking that you're diversifying, no, it doesn't work like that. There's so much involved in it. And so that's why I selected Richie May for my hedge fund accountant. And of course, you need pitch books to start. And you need an attorney. So I've selected a hedge fund attorney. They kind of do a template type of service. So, I mean, because they've done it so many times, they've created a template, what they offer and how much it costs. And of course, for pitch books, part of having your pitch books done, it's very important who you have that done by. You need somebody that has experience with knowing what institutional investors are going to ask and what they're looking for. So you need someone that has been raising capital for hedge funds or been an asset allocation or someone that knows a lot of people. And so I've decided that at this point I will pick probably one of the best in the industry. That's Holly Singer. She knows pretty much the best, and she has a great understanding of all the questions that those you know, big companies will ask and what they're looking for and how to project it out into a pitch book. That's the first step, is to really create your pitch books. And so that will be in 2022. I'll be working on all of that. And there's another question. A lot of people pitch me for to become investors. I want to thank all the people out there that reach out to me. I am looking for business partners. That's just how it is. That's a normal thing. But I'm looking for someone that has a personality that is like a go-getter. Someone who is not just good with management. I don't want someone that's good with management, because that's going to tell me that person, that's all they're good for. I want someone that is multi-talented with raising capital. Since I'm the one that selects the funds and deselects the funds and creates the portfolio, I'm not an expert on raising capital. I used to work in commercial real estate, so that's similar, but that's a little different. But I need someone that's a specialist in raising capital for the funds of funds. And someone that will go to those meetings with the companies who invest in emerging managers, produce all the documents that are needed, the communication, everything. That's a lot of work. And I, of course, can't do that by myself. Now, there's another question that people ask, and people do send me their business proposals, and I want to say thank you all for that, for sending those business proposals. At the moment, I'm not looking for anything, but I'm looking to start my own funds of funds. As of now, it's a hypothetical funds of funds. What does that mean? There's no money invested, but I've been following the same hedge funds for now 9 years, 8 years, I think, 8 years approximately. And yes, I have updated the funds with new funds over the past few years, and I continue it, because once funds get to a certain age and AUM, their returns get watered down. but it doesn't always happen. And so the funds of hedge funds that I have in my funds of funds, they're still doing really well. I'm really impressed by them. There's only 12 hedge funds that I've selected, and I have increased that to 12 this year. And that new person has only been around for 4 years, but this will be the fifth year. And they prove themselves to me on how they manage their risk. So part of investing in hedge funds, that's up to the actual hedge fund trader to manage their risk. Anyone that's a trader knows that in order to manage your risk, you have to manage your losing trades, as I mentioned previously. And so those traders that I've selected, whether they're men or women or whoever they may be, they do a really great job, and I'm very impressed. And so a word of advice for those big hedge fund managers out there who are 50 billion, 30 billion, whatever that AUM is, I would say it's time now that you separate your company. How about this? Instead of hiring traders to trade, since you're so big and you have so much capital, you're just repeating the same thing an investment bank has done. You created a trading floor. How about you give those individuals their own hedge fund and you become the funds of funds? Because if you do that, if the trader is cheating in any capacity, you relieve yourself legally, number one. Two, you're giving the responsibility to the trader to manage everything. Of course, not everyone is going to be able to do that, but that's okay, because there's many emerging hedge fund managers out there that are just starting out that need capital. And that's where you should be focusing on. You should really diversify. Because when you hire people as traders for your hedge fund, the return profile changes. And I have been analyzing your big hedge funds out there. I'm not telling you who I've done. I mean, I've looked at every big hedge fund out there. I can't remember the names. I don't look at the names. I just look at the AUM, and I put it into a database, and I've been calculating how it does in certain types of markets as we've progressed through time. And I noticed that your hedge fund, your returns are getting watered down. And unfortunately that happens, but I feel like when I look at the returns, they're sticking. I don't know how to explain it, but that's what I feel. I feel like it's sticking, like they are afraid to trade. Of course, they don't have their own company and they rely on other people to tell them what to do. Those are good employees, yeah. But if they were on their own, they could tweak their investment strategy. They could tweak their risk management approach to exit those losing trades. They could do a lot on their own, but because they're working for you, they can't. I mean, maybe you do allow it, but not to the degree where if they had their own hedge fund. So that will answer a number of questions, as well as there's another question. Okay, so I've answered this. What am I looking for? I'm looking to start my own hedge fund, my own funds of funds, etc. And I'm looking for a person to be the capital raiser, to raise capital for the funds of funds. That was answered. Now, the next question was a very important one. It was about, am I going to lose my money? So the question to that is very simple. No. If you invest in, let's say, 13 or 14 hedge funds, you've limit, or even 10, you've limit the risk to 10% in each hedge fund. So let's say you have, let's say, $1 million and you're putting $100,000 in each hedge fund, which is not really possible. I mean, because they, you know, you have a minimum that you have to put in, but let's say it's that low, or let's say it's $100 million and it's $10 million in each hedge fund. And so out of all those hedge funds, I don't see 5 of them negative in 1 year. It's never happened in the portfolio that I've created. Now, 2020 was a very important year for me. and for the traders, the hedge funds that are in my hypothetical portfolio. So was 08 and 09, but some of them are newer, so I couldn't test them out in that market. I mean, simulations aren't real. You could test it out with a computer and a simulation, but you're missing the human error, the human reasoning. And so that's why I wish that I could select hedge funds that are at least 7 to 10 years old, meaning that they have a track record, official track record of that they've been established for 8 to 10 years. Unfortunately, that's not possible because once they get up to that age, they've raised so much capital that they became too big. So what do you do? Well, you have to find the young ones, the ones that are 3 to 4 years old and continue following them. I have started to follow someone who was only 3 years old. Of course, just because they start a hedge fund and they have an official track record with an audit company, etc., it doesn't mean that they just started trading. No, they were trading probably between 3 and 6 years prior to that, because no one in their right mind is going to give someone that's only just trading 2 years capital to trade their money. That's psychotic. Okay, maybe they have a family member who's wealthy, a wife or a husband, and they put up capital, but trading $1 million is very different than trading $100 million. When I first started out, after I finished my PhD, I had to test out my risk management approach. And so I started trading options, but I knew it wasn't going to be a long-term career doing that. However, I perfected and tested out the methodology that I use to select hedge funds in a portfolio. And so that's how I improved it, because I had to actually be a trader in order to see what happens. And that's the gist of it. The next question is, do you look for a particular hedge fund based on what market they're trading in? Or what underlying assets are they trading in? Or do you care about that? So the reason it is a hedge fund is because it's a private company. You have to put your faith into that hedge fund manager to manage that capital. And you should not know or even try to know what they're investing in. That's up to them to manage their losses and to reverse that. So I know the SEC requires them after a certain amount of years or capital. I'm not an attorney, but I know that they are required to show what their underlying assets are. However, I think that the big companies are kind of ruining it for the hedge funds. So again, they're trying to control everything, and they're trying to do exactly what they did at the investment bank. They ruined it, because too much control ruins the quality. And so what happened was, at the investment banks, they kept recruiting people from different companies, and in out of nowhere, because everyone was moving around, all the companies out there were doing the exact same thing. So looking for talent and hiring someone from another company is a fantasy. And this is why the hedge funds, there's thousands of them, even if there's only 5,000, you have 5,000 different traders doing different methodologies, different trading styles, different return profiles. That's really important to have that quality in the creativeness, the different people doing different things. And so that's why the investment banks failed at managing people's capital. I know you probably don't know this, but investment banks, as we know it, is ending. The future of investment banking is going to be very different. So you have technology companies now where you could pay anything on an app. You could apply for a loan on an app. You don't need a bank, an actual bank to go to do any of that stuff. You don't need to have a bank manage your assets anymore. there's so many websites to look for startups and possibilities to make money. Back before the internet era, pretty much only the lucky people at the investment bank saw those IPOs or those startups. And so now today, there's a lot of new type of people who are not just letting someone else manage their assets. They want to take a part into managing their assets. So the whole idea of trusting an investment bank is over. They proved themselves to us in 08 and 09. And of course, that was really scary what happened, because you only had a handful left and all of the fingers to that hand went bankrupt. AIG went bankrupt, Bear Stearns went bankrupt, and officially the other ones had to borrow money to stay in business from the federal government. And that was the federal government's job, to lend them money, to be last resort to lend them money. And of course, Goldman Sachs was, Warren Buffett helped them stay in the business, and Bank of America bought Merrill Lynch to help them stay in business, but I believe they still need a loan from the federal government. And so that's the demise of the investment banks when they all merged together, and somehow the government changed people's pensions, that you had to hold your pension in your own hand, which created that basically everyone does the same thing. But before the 1980s, those companies, they were really creative, especially when you had the owner of the company still there. And you had people that stayed at one company their whole life. And so the other company had their own staff that was there for many years. And in a way, when your staff is there for many years, they kind of know what's going on, and they know the mistakes, and they remember the mistakes that the company made. And those mistakes don't get happen again, that don't happen again. But when you have people that move from company to company, just because they're getting $10,000 more to get signed up at a new company, after only a couple of years of being at the other company, what are they actually bringing to the company? It's zero. It's garbage. It's almost like they're just surviving at the company until their next opportunity. And giving them incentives and huge bonuses to stay, that's another reason why they're just doing the minimum. Because what does a person actually do at a company? Well, you do a fraction of what the company does. And it's all about managing today's tasks or managing people or groups. This is what I'm saying about portfolio managers coming into the hedge fund industry and working for the funds of funds. They're ruining our industry again. And so, of course, it's good to have your own business because you could do something different. And as in my case, that's what I want to do. And this is another reason why I believe so much in having your own business, is because I could improve and deselect or select a hedge fund based on whatever reasons, based on my strategy. And the outcome is the actual returns. And that's how it works. In the end, you look at the returns. And so to say to yourself, am I going to lose my money? No. Yes, there's going to be two hedge funds that are negative in that portfolio. In 2020, I did have two hedge funds that were negative in my hypothetical portfolio. I made a video on this, and I went through each of the hedge funds, and basically I told you what the returns were. The first five, they were above between 50 and 60%. The next two, there were two that actually did past 150%. Much higher, I'm not telling you how much. And there were two that would do 20%. And the rest, there were two negative, etc. So there was 12 hedge funds in that portfolio, 12 or 13 at that time. I did get rid of one this year, moving forward, and I'll be testing out another one. I need another year's trading return before I could accept that in my hypothetical portfolio, but that's the point. Things change over time. So if you're trying to pick how I do things, things change very rapidly. And that I would I have to make sure that those changes happen. So I had a funds of funds call me up recently, and they asked me like very detailed questions. And I was very impressed by the questions that they asked, and it was interesting that, you know, I got to speak with them. But in the end, it was kind of like a insult that they would try to steal secrets from another company. And so I told them to read my hedge fund research, but that's 8 years old. I've improved it dramatically. So I'm never giving you the actual strategy. And if you ask me that, I'm just gonna give you a colorful explanation, just like every hedge fund manager does. And so I hope that this video has answered a lot of questions that a lot of people ask. I get so many emails every day and so many phone calls that I want to thank all of you for reaching out to me. It's great. And if we do talk and I don't get back to you, please send me a message again, because with the emails every day, a lot of stuff gets lost. You know, this is not my full-time job. I wish it was once I get funded. But as of now, things could fall through the cracks. And so I want to thank you so much for watching. And I want to thank everyone for following me on LinkedIn. Those 1,500 followers, I'm really impressed by that. And I want to thank you so much. Those are people in the financial industry that are following me. And that really makes a lot. That really shows me that my videos and what I know means a lot. And I want to thank all the people on LinkedIn that are connected to my profile. So there's like 3,000 people that have connected to my profile since I started doing these videos. It's only a couple months that I started this. And as for the people on YouTube, there's not a lot of subscribers. That's going to change soon. I figured out how to get people to come to my YouTube channel now. And so the next video I post on LinkedIn, it's going to be a little bit different how I post it. I actually made a mistake. I'm supposed to make it so that the video, you click on it and it brings you to YouTube so that I get credit on YouTube. Because as of now, I don't get credit for that 1,500 followers and 300 views on each video. And so I want to thank you so much for watching. Please reach out to me if you have questions or if you have business opportunities that you want me to share with others. Maybe I can make a video on analyzing those business opportunities for you. As well as the hedge fund managers, please remember to send me your returns. I do look at them and I do analyze them. I don't get back to you, but if you want me to get back to you, tell me that. So I want to thank you so much. Happy holidays and Happy New Year.